And are you refreshed? Good. Now what?
Thank you, Abraham. You're beautiful too.
So there's a few things I'd like to talk about. Energy. So we get food is energy. Sunlight gives us energy. Meditation gives us energy. Pure, positive energy as our beings. What exactly is energy?
Well, let's just call it the fuel of the universe. We have a really important question for you. If a tree falls in the forest and there's no one to hear it, did it make a sound?
No.
No. And so, if there's no one there to eat the energy, was there any energy? In other words, it's the receiving of it, the translating of it into something that is important. It's the stuff of the universe, but it has to be focused and utilized. When we talk about energy, we prefer to talk about your cellular response to the energy, because your cells, trillions of cells in your body, are the most efficient receivers and utilizers of energy. It's the stuff that the universe made of, and of course there are lots of different labels that describe it. But why does it matter to you? We're not saying that it shouldn't. We're wanting to know.
So I think of our bodies as like a battery, and there's a certain amount of energy in that. And I'm just curious how we can raise our vibration to get more energy.
We really like the way you are directing the conversation, because when we encourage you to quiet your mind, which stops resistance, because it's resistance that is the drag on your energy. It's the resistance that blocks it. That's too strong of a word. You know that. You know that from your physics in your physical world, that resistance is what slows everything down. And so when we speak of meditation as a way of releasing resistance so that your vibration can rise, so that then what's in the vortex can be received by you, we call that the receptive mode. But an equally good description of it is it's the replenishing mode. That's the best part about what you want to call your sleep state. Your body doesn't need to rest. You're resting while you're sitting. Often your body is at rest, but the energetic rest that is important means allowing the resistance to subside so that the energy that really is the pure stuff that is the makeup of that which you are can be received by you and utilized by you. So in the same way that you're talking about a fuel line that is crimped or a battery that is on low power, that's the way most humans run around when they are disallowing the fullness of their alignment with contradictory thoughts. Let's call a pure desire, what we were talking about for the first hour here today, as full power. And let's talk about a belief that contradicts it as reduced power in some way. And so replenishment is about releasing resistance. It's also about tuning into the energy, but it's just opposite ends of the same stick, isn't it? If you weren't doing that thing you do that you've picked up along your physical trail, you'd be in full power all the time. And you would sleep very little, because the sleep isn't important. It's the reduction of resistance that is important.
So as far as light and sound and vibration, are they all the same thing? Are they all energy? Or are they energy that's just manifested into a physical?
Well, the label is irrelevant. The word that Esther finds, because she doesn't have a scientific, sophisticated vocabulary, the word that she finds is vibration. And we say to you that you are interpreters of vibration. And so what you see is an interpretation of a vibration, and that's why you see light. What you hear is an interpretation of vibration. And of course, these are vibrations at different frequencies, and your mechanisms are able to decipher them. And you do that so well, you don't even know you're doing it, even to the point that you don't even realize, for the most part, that you are energy beings. But when we begin talking about the non-physical part of you, really, when the discussion moves into emotions, that's when it is really a discussion about energy, because your emotions are letting you know about the blending of the energies between the high frequency, pure positive, non-resistant inner being you and the physical you who is some resisted version of that. So the words don't matter to us. Do they matter to you?
I don't think they do. I'm just trying to...
What are you driving at?
So one of the things that I'm wondering is, okay, when we pass from the physical to non-physical...
Then you'll reemerge into pure positive energy and you'll leave the resistance behind. But you don't have to croak to do that. You can meditate and accomplish it too.
I understand that. But what I'm wondering is, say, when we do croak, do we have the option of coming right back, or do we sit in for what I'm going to say, a certain amount of time into the non-physical before we're allowed to come back?
There's no allowing. It's all your deliberate creation. It's all about what you want.
Okay.
And only from your human perspective would you ask that question, because it's lack-based.
Okay. Makes sense.
Because from your non-physical perspective, non-physical, we are as involved in your life as you think you are, and we are non-physically focused. And so it's a mix of all of these energies. And so it's not one or the other. You're not non-physical and then physical and then non-physical and physical. Really, the discussion that we're wanting to bring into the forefront is about how much of that which you always are you letting be here with you now? You have the option of lighting up a room with your clarity, or of sort of just dragging around with your resistant thoughts.
So when you see somebody light up, what are you seeing at that point? Is that the vibration?
Give us a more literal description of what you mean.
You say when you pick people out here in the audience that you're looking for people to light up. And I'm just curious what you're seeing.
There are a number of things that we want to say to you about that. The criteria that we utilize in order to find you in the room. First of all, it's the blend of who you all are. It's the collective asking that you are about and the focus that you are about. That's the first criteria. And so we are choosing those as our highest priority who have formulated what they want to talk about in the most effective way for the most to hear what they most want. Because we know everyone's not going to sit in the hot seat. And in fact, most of you are better not sitting in the hot seat, because you're more likely to hear your answer when you're not under fire here. So it's what questioner has the question that is of greatest value to answer what most are asking. Next, it's someone who has a clear desire, who is somewhere in the vibrational vicinity of receiving it. And then third, sometimes someone has a really powerful desire and they're not in the vibrational vicinity, but their desire is so powerful that we go for it anyway, and it's usually boring to the group, but it matters so much to that person. Their desire is so powerful that that's how it happens. And it's always a combination of all of those things. These questions about energy are important to this leading edge discussion, while they are usually not what the majority of people in a room want to talk about, because you can't really get your thoughts around them and there are no words that adequately describe them. We would rather you say, I'm watching the way I feel and I care about feeling enthusiasm and I care about feeling love and I really like the feeling of interest, and so I'm guiding my thoughts not because of their energetic nature, but because of my awareness of how little or much resistance I have on a subject. Think about what we were talking about earlier. The difference between thinking a thought and receiving a thought. Well, when you receive a thought, you're translated it in your own mind, and so it feels to you like you're thinking it, but you're really receiving more than you're thinking. When you feel a strong effort in a thought, you're usually projecting the thought, not receiving it. And so physical life in your human body is all about all of that. And so now we're talking about thoughts. We're not talking about energy, and we're not talking about vibration. We're talking about energy. But what we really want to talk about is emotions. What we really want to talk about, the only thing that we really want to talk about, is you and you. And we want you and you to be blended together so much more of the time that you're knowing your power and you're feeling your bliss and you're living happily ever after. But humans, you keep wanting to decipher everything and understand everything. And the more complicated it gets, then usually the less easy it is to apply. So,
how about staying more into step four? How do we go about that?
We'll talk about that later. Yeah, we'll talk about that when it fits in with what's going on.
Okay, so I have one more thing I just want to wrap up. So about a year ago, there was a moment when I would say I was very lucid with a thought, with my inner being. I just wonder if you can confirm that or not.
Well, we don't want you to need confirmation from us. That's really the point of all of this. Yes, but we don't want you to need an answer from us. You got to play around with it to even know if you've quieted your mind. And then you got to play with it around it a little more until you can actually feel an elevation of your emotions. And then you've got to receive an impulse, and it's got to feel like something you really want to do for any of this to even make any sense. And then you follow the impulse out to see the power of it. Esther was daydreaming about something the other day for the bliss of it, not for the making something happen, for the sheer bliss of it. And that's really the reason we want you to do it, is for the bliss of the moment, not because it's productive. But it is productive, but we want you to do it for the bliss of it, not because it's productive, but it is really productive. But we don't want you to do it because it's productive, because if you do it because it's productive, then you don't do the bliss. Then you get in that efforting thing. And so within about 12 hours, so many things had come into her experience. Things had turned to thoughts and impulses, but then the vibration had turned to thoughts, and the thoughts had turned to impulses. But then she started finding things. She sat on an airplane with people who are a piece of what this dream is, and she knows it. She knows it as soon as she began visiting with them. She knows it from the things that they were talking about and from the things that they showed her of their talents on their iPad. In other words, there's no question in her mind. And then once she landed, she's at home sort of sorting through a stack of things that were on her desk that have been there for quite a long time, because she's been on a cruise, and then she went to Asheville, and then she did this, and then she did this. So she had some stuff piled up. Some of it had been there for a few months. It was a sort of selected pile of stuff that she'd sifted and thought, I'd get back to it later. And she reached in it. There were three things in that pile that are directly related to this daydream she's been dreaming. Now, that's not meaningful to you, but it is meaningful to Esther. And this is what we're getting at with you, is that once you take effort out of the equation, which means you don't try to make it happen, you let it happen. You don't try to think the thought, you receive the thought. And that really is what step four is. Step four is being the master at that. Step one is you ask, and you're usually not in such a good place when you do it. Step two is source answers and gets your vortex all going and the cooperative components get gathered. Step three is what we've been talking about. You meditate, you allow your vibration to rise, and you receive an impulse. Step four is you get really, 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 really good at that. You're so good at it that you can do it at will. You're so good at it that you know when you're doing it and you know when you're not doing it. You're so good at it that you don't mind when you're not doing it, because you can do it anytime you want. And then step five is, you've been doing that and you're really good at it. We've called you a master. Step four, you've mastered it, mastered it, mastered it. And step five is, now contrast has come into your experience again, and you are so happy for the contrast because you understand how it all fits together. You're no longer mad at yourself for negative emotion. Instead, you understand that negative emotion is an indication of a productive moment. It's an indication of a strong asking. It's an indication of vortex building. It's an indication of clarification happening. And you also know that the negative emotion will pass and that you will not hold yourself in that place. Now you know that, maybe more clearly than you have before. Enough?
Enough. Thank you.
Really good. Yeah. Really good.